One, and we're recording. So I'm back with Joseph. Joseph, how are you?
I'm great. How are you, Sonny?
Oh man, I am well. It has been a roller coaster of a ride. I think just even since the last time you and I kind of did this thing about a month ago.
That's an understatement, I think.
Understatement, right? I mean, I don't know who was saying this the other day, but they were like, in crypto, it's like, every day is like the equivalent of like a year or something in most other industries.
And we're all going to be old and retired in about
in a big way.
Times as fast as normal people.
It's crazy. So I guess in terms of, you know, so context, we did like an hour and a half or something session, maybe about a month ago. And if people want to kind of catch up on, you know, your story and learn about like that, which was really popular. Actually, I was pretty surprised. Like a lot of people were viewing it in comparison to my other videos. So if people want to check that out, they can. But today we were going to more kind of take off from where we left off last time, right? And we were really kind of set, and this is something that it's like a bit of a theme that maybe it's just more like something that I think about and I bring up in a lot of my shows as well, is this conversation around this regulation. You know, I know Brian Armstrong recently tweeted about it. There's a lot of people within the Bitcoin community that have concerns, and as do I, and so I'm always interested in, you know, in looking at like how do you solve problems effectively, right? And you know, I think one of the ultimate goals that you kind of said in near the end of your last interview was, you know, I think it's kind of recognized by regulators around the world that this technology is here to stay, for whatever reason that may be, whether it's too expensive to try and get rid of, or, you know, for other reasons, because it creates jobs, you know, on the more positive note. But there are, as you also mentioned rightfully, there are risks associated with these technologies. Like if people are doing nefarious activities, you know, there are certain things in the world that I think everyone can agree that, you know, we don't want. So how do you address you know, those types of issues, and how do you do it using technology? How do you do it, you know, in a way that preserves sovereignty and I think people's identity, and, you know, gives people control of their lives, right? And that's kind of the ultimate, I think, goal. So with that said, yeah, maybe I'll turn it over to you. What do you? I don't. I mean, just as a starter, how has life been in the last month or so? Are you keeping healthy? Keeping well?
I've been keeping healthy. Yeah, I'm not in Canada in -40, as I think I said in my last one. So makes it a bit easier. Not a lot of COVID where I am. But that's big. No, but I think, like, I mean, the markets are just like, you know, they drive all things, I think, in the space in many different ways. Like, I'm almost happy that we kind of waited a month before doing this next one, just because there's been so much regulatory shift and, you know, no pun intended. It's just been like a mixture of like amazing growth, really Bitcoin's coming out exactly as we kind of all had predicted. You're starting to see institutions coming, which is super exciting. And right. I actually think that this type of momentum is a bit, you know, more justified than 2017. And I think it's kind of here to stay. So that's really exciting. And I think on the regulatory side, I mean, for better and for worse, like the ecosystem is starting to really understand the problems that you're mentioning, right? Like, we've been kind of kicking and screaming for 3 years. And I was saying this earlier that, like, you know, there's certain things that, like, the major world is okay with, and there's certain ways and approaches to things that they just don't operate, you know, in the same context of our space. And so, you know, we have to figure out ways of merging these two worlds together and kind of creating that bridge, right? And that's, as I was saying in kind of the earlier interview, you know, that's really what we've been trying to do, is saying, like, listen, like, there will come this intersection, which I think we're actually at that Goldilocks moment right now. And we need infrastructure and we need tooling that can, you know, support the ecosystem, but also allow this kind of co-integration to happen. I'm unfortunate. It's some of the non-custodial stuff we can get into is a bit scarier, I think. And we kind of always viewed it to come in some form, didn't expect the US to do what they've been doing now, in so much force, let's say. But Yeah, overall, it's been a pretty good month.
Actually, you know, one of my favorite things to do is to dive into the deep end, you know, and to kind of talk about pink elephants. And that is something that is kind of top of mind, right? So recently there's been some, you know, I guess you could say back and forth in the United States, right, between regulators and the industry. And from what I've been tracking, at least, it seems like there's been an overwhelming amount of feedback from like all across the board, right? And so, but if you had to try and give somebody a TLDR on kind of that whole issue, because I mean, like I said, people are kind of all over the world, right? When people tune in or whatever. So, but if people are listening to this, you know, what is this? What do you think it means, I guess, in terms of?
So maybe I'll kind of like, I'll finish with like the history that I started with last time, because I think this is mm-hmm. relevant, right? Like in 2017, 16, 18, like there was not a lot. We kind of had this impression in the ecosystem that we were untouchable. You know, we're invincible. Censorship resistance is what makes Bitcoin amazing. You can't stop this. You can't do anything. You can't touch us. And we had that, you know, kind of drive from 2010, 11, 12, 13 and on. And like we had kind of looked at it as like, we kind of, that was the one thing that we believed not to be true, where I think everyone else believed it to be true. You know, it's kind of that, you know, that one thing that we had very deep conviction on is like, that, you know, the real world can make impactful change to our ecosystem. Bitcoin doesn't care about regulation. It doesn't care about anything. It's Bitcoin will progress. But like the question was like, how do we ensure it progresses into the right places, right? And so like in 2017, there's a very small group of us. Sorry, let me just turn this off. There's a very small group of us that kind of said, listen, like no one else who were the early old timer OGs or whatever you want to call them, were like really trying to solve this regulatory challenge, right? And we kind of looked at it as like in the next 3 to 5 years, if this ecosystem does what we think it will do, going to 40K as an example, there will come a point where this is the biggest battleground that we have. And so, you know, from about 2017, 16 till now, there's been a group of people that have been working with international organizations to really try to educate in the first context. And you've been a part of this, Sonny, in many ways at the OECD. But also really like as with a core like construct of trying to keep the ecosystem from becoming, you know, a product of the dark or part of the world, right? And really driving it into the light that comes with trade-offs. That is not, you know, it's not like, oh, full anonymization and privacy of money. Like that's a big challenging topic to a world that deals and battles with terrorist financing and everything. And whether you like KYC or not, like that's just a function of how, you know, institutions try to solve these problems. And there's a myriad of other ones, securities law, international taxation, all of the above. And so, you know, in 2016, 2017, we kind of looked at it and said, there will come a point where this is an issue. We need to look at infrastructure built on top of the systems that we've been building in the space today. We need to maintain openness. We need to maintain decentralization, but we also need to maintain privacy of users and individuals. And I think over the last few weeks, you're seeing, you know, platforms like Twitter and Facebook, and this big privacy debate is like really getting front and center. So it's kind of this intersection of all these issues. But I think that like there's
privacy and censorship, right?
Yeah, well. Like censorship is such a good example, right? Like these are going to be the, I think, in the next decade.
Joseph, Deutsche Bank today just announced that they're not going to be dealing with Trump anymore.
No way.
What? So, I mean, whether you love Trump or hate him, he was or is, I think, still the president of the United States,
at least
of America. And he was literally just cut off from a bank, one of the major banks. That's anyway. Sorry, continue. That's like nuts. Right? Like I can't even believe I'm saying that.
Like the last year has been so amazing at just giving real world examples to like the majority of like why we've been building. You know, like why Bitcoin is important, why crypto is important, why decentralization matters, why privacy, like, you know, it's like a perfect melting pot of just the weirdest things happening. But again, like, you know, there, in order for us to get these institutions in, like the reason institutional adoption is happening is it's on the back of regulation, right? It's, we need to be able to ensure that risk can be understood and how we deal with these risks, right? Like there are inherent trade-offs. If we want Bitcoin and the ecosystem to grow, we need to be able to kind of speak the language of the world.
Hey, Joseph, just give me a second, man. I'm going to just give me 1 second. Two, one. Okay, cool. Yeah. Sorry about that. Continue.
Yeah, so we have like these myriad of issues, and like there are these trade-offs, right? And anyone who thinks that like we can operate kind of in the way that the space does today with no changes to how these systems, like how we operate against these systems, and expect traditional, very old institutions, you know, very different traditional ways of thinking to merge with that, I think is a very tough challenge, right? And so it's all about finding that balance, right? And so the last 3 years has been like in a very quiet fashion, like been a group of people that have really been, you know, in the ears of some of the largest world leaders, you know, the largest regulators, central bank heads. And what we've been trying to do is educate them and try to eliminate the fear involved in this and really have them understand, like, these are how you deal with risks. There's very good tools for like actually tracking things and being able to understand compliance. And like, you don't have to ban things, because like there is a very real, you know, chance that things like bans were coming. Let's get into the US in a second, but I think that's something that Mnuchin is kind of trying to do. There's still people in the world that want to kill this, whether we like it or not. Like, they do have the power to create fundamental shifts in the way our ecosystem works. We only really learned that in the last year and a half, and it's because of regulation. And so this is very real, and it's a very big threat to the space. And we've been doing everything that we can in the background to try to keep this happening at an international level with the Financial Action Task Force and the OECD and the Bank of International Settlements and the FSB, to try to, you know, keep the balance and understand, like, this is, we understand your issues and where your risks are, but don't focus on everything, focus on a few things. And so that's been a lot of work. And throughout that time, we wrote the first regulations in Bermuda, which really act as a framework that a lot of Commonwealth countries have started implementing in terms of how you deal with digital assets, how you deal with crypto. So you can kind of think of a part of the work that we've been doing is like acting as kind of this invisible hand for the space to try to progress things forward. And that takes us up, you know, closer to today. At the same time, what we were doing was working on infrastructure to solve, you know, the problems that SWIFT solves, as an example, because a lot of the incoming challenges that the ecosystem has is that the traditional world looks at SWIFT, looks at identity information movements. They look at KYC as a critical requirement. When you're dealing with open payment systems, you could imagine how they have to change their thinking in order to, you know, somehow match that. And that change in thinking leads to policy. It leads to the regulations that come, and our ecosystem doesn't work the same way. And that means the impacts and effects those things have when applied into our ecosystem change the ecosystem itself, right? And so this is like the big battle that I think we have, and there's a huge amount of complexity, and it requires collaboration in the ecosystem, like immense collaboration. This isn't as sexy as DeFi or other parts of the space that a lot of people are raving about, but it is the things that enable the space to move forward. And that's what we've always wanted to do, is solve problems that impact billions of people.
Hey, Joseph, you know, I mean, kind of part of the fun thing about this being, you know, just some thing that I made up or whatever that I'm doing here is like, we can kind of go wherever we want. But I wanted to do one thing is that, what's your favorite book again? What's the title of it?
Which one?
The one by, it's called Sovereign Something, The Sovereign Individual. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yeah. So I was going to ask you, so I had that book on my shelf. I've actually started reading it now. But if you had to give someone a TLDR, like again, like a little quick like paragraph or a couple sets, you know what I mean? A bit on what the takeaway on that book is. Because that's a book that resonates, I'd say, with a lot of, you know, people in Bitcoin, believers in liberty. But I wanted to start with kind of a floor on in terms of like this whole conversation.
Yeah, like, so it's really about, like, in my view, and I didn't read this, like, I didn't get into Bitcoin after reading it. I've only read it over the last few years, but it was so impactful for me because, like, in my view, it's a roadmap for the entire ecosystem. And I do believe that Bitcoin is the gateway drug, for lack of a better term, that actually enables what the sovereign individual kind of describes. And it's this idea that, like, where the future is going, when privacy technologies and open systems and financial integrity systems, let's call it, and ownership at the individual level becomes where we actually see it kind of going today, there will just be these modifications or recreations of a lot of the way that the world works, right? Whether it's about like, do people live in any one place, or the ability to, you know, travel to different places. Assets are all completely digitized. The way that we operate is in an entirely digital format, but entirely private in a lot of these systems. And it's really about like, yeah, how you create this like idea of sovereignty at the individual level in all formats, right? So it's not just about the sovereignty of money or assets. It's the sovereignty of where you live, how you actually, how you work, where you work, why you do things in a certain context. Like it's, it is my view. And I've just thought about it over the last 20 years since the book came out. It's actually kind of happening before our eyes. So if you want a roadmap for like where everything's going, that is the most amazing book to kind of give that.
And so how does identity come into this future? Yeah. Hopefully, okay, so there's two worlds we could move into. One is one of complete tyranny and collapse and like, you know, kind of like, I mean, in many ways, the way the world's going. And then there is this other side, right? Where, you know, like even AI or Bitcoin or any technology, robotics, like it can be used for good or it can be used for evil type of thing, right? So, yeah. But curious, like how does identity play into this narrative now? Like if I am someone like who buys into this narrative that yes, I want to be a free individual. Okay, I get how Bitcoin helps me. Like to me, at least, I see a direct relationship between how Bitcoin and freedom relate, because it goes up in value, gives you more time to do shit you want to do and focus more on problems you want to solve. You get to like own it, as in it's yours. Like you get to bury it, you know, or whatever, memorize your codes, and you've got your assets, and no one can just come, yep, and just arbitrarily take it away from you. So there's these elements of Bitcoin, and I also like the fact that I don't have to associate my identity with Bitcoin too, right? In the sense that I do when I have to go to an exchange because they have to deal with banks, but if I also want to, you know, use a hardware wallet or whatever, paper wallet for that matter, I can disassociate to some extent, right? But curious now, so if we again use sovereignty and freedom as like a base layer, how does identity now become like, how would one think about, or you know, how do you think about identity?
Yeah, like, and this is also why like
from we, first principles. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, like the first principles is like, what does it mean to be free? What does it mean to, you know, be a sovereign individual, right? Like the idea is that like, I'm an individual. Well, I am an identity, like in my core, but I'm also multiple identities, right? Like, and like my ability to own assets, I think in my view, and who I am in being able to opt in and out of systems. I'm the one opting in. It's me. My identity is opting into different things, right? That's like the most critical next pillar, I think. Like you, like, whether there's so many ways that you can define it, but like you need some way of being able to control who you are and being able to opt into systems with who you are for the purpose of use or utilization. And whether that be like, I'm opting into a country, I'm opting into, you know, a network, a communication system, I'm opting into a financial service, I'm opting into a lending or loan system. It's all about me or us as individuals, right? And what it means to be sovereign is to be able to control that and to find that freedom and being able to have choice, right? I think that like the way that the world's gone today is like we've lost the ability to choose. We're forced into systems. And I think that like where our space is driving us, and Bitcoin is a great example of that, is like we can now use technology as a way to alleviate ourselves or unshackle ourselves from the way of forced opt-ins and the way of doing things that we have today. It creates more options. It creates more free market infrastructure across everything, right? And so like, I think identity is like critical. Like we also have to understand a lot of us live in North America and in the Western world. And like we take for granted a lot of things like identity, right? The ability to access credit, the ability to properly own a piece of property, like land titles, all of these things are linked to us as an identity. And a lot of the world doesn't even have identity. So how do you even like do basic things at the most fundamental level when you don't even and can't even properly represent yourself? So today we think about identity, and my view is like, oh, I have a government issued identity, but I don't think that that's like the end goal, right? I think it's like, how do I start to aggregate the data, the interactions that I have, and control those things, but enable the use of those things in entirely new ways, right? Like, how do I use my reputation as a new form of credit creation? Can I start creating new lending systems that aren't based on antiquated ways of doing things, right? Like, there's just like, and it also opens up this privacy problem, which I think is like the biggest issue we're starting to face. you know, WhatsApp right now is forcing us to opt into their service and get take all of our data effectively in the next few weeks. Like, you know, that's like, it's, that shouldn't be a yes or no, come into our system or get out. You know, and so it's like, we have, and that's my identity. They're asking me for all my identity data, right? And so there's all of these issues that revolve around it. Most people don't really think of it like that. They think of it as like, oh, the government has an identity and et cetera. But everything that we do creates an identity. When I write a Bitcoin transaction, right? When I'm signing a transaction, that is a form of identity, right? Like, it is a part of my financial identity. The addresses that I hold are a part of, you know, that finance, that identity fabric, you know? And so it's really about like, how do you start, like, I think giving the ability for consent back to users so that we know where our data is and ultimately how we start aggregating all of these different things we do every day into systems or a system that's owned and controlled by us. And I think that's like the biggest form of power at the end of the day is like, you know, is your own ability or your option to control it. It doesn't mean everyone's going to want to control all their all their data or all their identities. And that's okay. But like, we need to start like in my view, like Bitcoin has changed the way that people think. We're creating like a change in social consciousness, right? And that's what like, I think this space is doing. And I think that like, as you progress down these other layers of individual sovereignty and ownership, these are the next big ones, right? Like the ability to opt in and out of a country, the ability to say, I am opting out of a country because I do not believe the way that this government operates is right. And I am porting my identity and all of my things out in a digital fashion. I think that's the holy grail. And I think that that's where, you know, we move to. So I don't know.
So yeah, no, that makes sense. That makes sense. So in terms of identity, obviously being core, like, you kind of touched on it a little bit, but like, you know, when like the average Joe, right, or even myself, like when I think of the word identity, first thing I think of is my driver's license. I think of my passport. I think of things like that, right? And yep. and obviously those systems feel very antiquated. But you know, you're talking about something like beyond that, right? In the sense that like that, but something maybe encompasses that, but maybe even further than that. But like the idea is so okay. Let me just get to the point. So recently, there's been all these hacks of these like central databases, right? So whether you look at was it Equifax or one of those yeah. ones, or I forget which one it was, but I mean, these are. Like when I think of identity, again, as like a person who doesn't, let's say, think about it every day, or I do, but I'm just saying, like, let's say my mom or someone who thinks about these things, they're going, okay, well, like if these, those are like the sanctuaries, right? They're like the churches of identity, because you think, well, they're managing our credit. And based on that credit, I get, you know, XYZ company will decide my fate, and they themselves are being hacked. Right. So yep. To me, that strikes me as like, wait, something's really messed up about the way we do identity today as well, because like, you know, even like it's everything's just centralized and it's all brought into these like, you know, centralized servers. So I've always felt that, you know, maybe identity could be disrupted right at its core as well. And it shouldn't be like that. But I'm just wondering, like, and it feels like more and more that governments are making rules to create these honeypots, right? And so, 100%. So can you kind of speak to that a little bit? Like what's happening right now in the world, and how does this tech, this world, this blockchain, Bitcoin world, potentially help address some of these like major concerns that everyone should have, right? I mean,
we've been working on this for like a while. And like, I think ultimately it's like the more that you can distribute information, but not just continuing to take my full name and my first name and my last name and putting it everywhere. Like the more we can take pieces of data from all these different places or be able to fully control the entirety of that data set. Like we need to come to, and I think our space is driving forward this concept that we can start to decentralize or distribute information entirely, right? And so like that, I think, is the ultimate holy grail. I mean, like the best example is like two of them. FinCEN, which is the regulator in the US, has this treasure trove of data. To make things worse, the regulations they just put out for crypto are basically requiring every person with a transaction in and out of an exchange, even if they're not your customer, to now send the identity data to FinCEN. And then 3 weeks ago or a few months ago, FinCEN got hacked and all this data. So we're basically like, hold up. So you're telling us that you're forcing us under regulatory requirements to expose privacy, violate entire sets of information from users that have nothing to do with, quite frankly, the United States in many cases. And on top of that, you're putting it in a place that is very well not designed to secure and store this data. And you're expecting us to trust that you're just going to like use things and do things properly with, again, none of our knowledge in what you do. Another one is like Canada, the CRA got hacked. Like while they were sending payments out, and then they were sending more payments out for aid and everything over during, unfortunately, the COVID crisis we've been in. But it's like, what? Like, that doesn't make sense. Like, there has to be other ways of doing this. And I think even more importantly, like, why do I walk into a bank and then another bank and another bank and constantly have to give them the same? Like, why am I giving them my passport and all these things 10, 15, 50 times? Like, there has to be some layer of trust that allows these institutions or these ecosystems to communicate my data.
When you mention it though, Joseph, I also think about my doctors. Like, yeah, I don't even have a constant identity across my health system, for example. Like, I don't, you know what I mean? Like, when I go from one doctor to the next, I'm having to tell him, regurgitate, and then, you know, what my problems are from the past guy. Like, ideally, they should all have a common language that they could speak. But I know what you mean. Like, it just seems like identity is like kind of done in like a very haphazard way. Like, if you're an alien, which maybe those exist now, who knows? You know, if you're trying to figure out identity on this planet, you'd be like, whoa, it's like just like duct tape here, a little bit of Lego, you know, holding something up, maybe something 3D printed in the corner.
The macro of it, it's like everything is chaotic, disorganized system that doesn't really make sense in half the places. That kind of makes sense in the other half. Like, you have like records and folders and files and who knows where that holds all of your most important information. And like, you're just expected to be like, no, it's okay, it's all good. But yeah, like, this doesn't make sense, right? Like, there needs to be like some sort of a change, right? And it's like, even from an economic perspective, like, if you can solve the problems in organization of information or the distribution of information in more secure and efficient ways, like, we always underprice the cost of security in any system. But like, the cost of not having a hack is massive. Why don't you change the way security works of data? Like, why don't you just change the way consent works? Why don't you give people more access? Why don't you enable data markets, or at least Joseph will opt into WhatsApp? Because you're gonna pay me 10 cents or whatever it is for my data. Like, I'm fine with you using it, but I need to understand why it's being used, where it's being used. Do you really need this? Like, it's about, like, it's ours, right? Like, it's the, you know, if the product is free, then you are the product, right? And that's one side of it.
And I know we're going to get into like the meat of all the, like, everything else, but I just, before we do, cause I, like, again, I don't want to, like, the word identity, it carries a lot of weight with, not a weight, but it's just, it's a word that's kind of, like, you know what I mean? But I wanna first of all, like, kind of give it some context in like everyday meaning, right? So there is this thing about Equifax, FinCEN, like you said, the financial world. But then when I think about identity, there's this other part of identity, which is like my Facebook identity, my Twitter identity, my like online identity, my social identity or whatever, right? Yeah. So identity really takes form in a lot of different ways, if you will, right? But I'm just wondering, like, I haven't like seen those two worlds collide. Like, I think you alluded to it earlier, which is that, or I know other people have been mentioning this to me too, is that, let's say I had zero credit. I had, like, just because I live in some part of the world where I just... But I have like an amazing social network where people are like totally validating the fact, and I've, you know, I've proved things, and let's say I have whatever, people should be able to, you know, leverage that identity too, to maybe for financial purposes and things like that. That hasn't quite happened, but it feels like, again, that's maybe a function of this like duct tape, Lego, you know, half, you know, put together model.
But like, I also think that it's like the big reason those systems haven't worked is because like we've lacked the ability historically up until Bitcoin to be able to create systems where we can define trust on the internet, right? Like, it's very hard to trust two different companies, the users between them, interactions between people. There's no way of building mechanical trust, you know, at a physical level other than writing contracts and hoping people are, you know, adhering to them. Like, the more that like Bitcoin or blockchains the Bitcoin guys are probably not going to like this part of the discussion, more about less about privacy and more of a debate, but like that's ultimately where I think like we need to like move to is like, and where we are moving to is like, we need to re-architect the way that organization and trust occurs across all of these intermediaries that we have. And the more that we can, you know, enforce rule sets between counterparties, banks, insurance companies, even social like Twitter, between myself and everything that I do, it creates and re-architects the way of us like perceiving value, right? And that's where like I think that the end of this goes is like you create these socially embedded data markets where like, you know, everything acts as a function of price discovery. The cost of something is being redeemed by participants within that system, myself to you, myself to a bank, myself to my employer, whatever it may be. Right. But like, we've never had an ability to do that. And I think that that starts to change over time as our ecosystem starts to expand. On the side of the reputation is really what I think like you're kind of getting at. Like, that's really, in my view, what I find both very scary, but also very, very interesting. Like, if we can get it right, and a lot of Bitcoin guys will say like reputation is very hard to do, if not, you know, a terrible thing and everything. And that's where I think the big, like, the experiment right now is has to be done very carefully, is like identity can be used very well if built properly, but it also can be used, you know, for surveillance and things like that. So getting digital identity right is like kind of at the forefront of, I think, the policy side, the engineering side, and so on and so forth. But like the ultimate vision that, like, in my view, I think is like, as you're saying, the holy grail is this idea that I can aggregate all of these things together, right? Like, I can aggregate all my social data, the types of information I have between how I communicate with people, you know, the trust that I have across pretty much everything. Like, credit scores are ridiculous. Makes no sense. Like, I even have problems with credit cards, and I've been in Bitcoin for like 10 years. Like, I'm doing pretty good. Like, but I have problems with like credit because I have a phone bill I didn't pay when I was like 19. You know, like, yeah, that is not like a good indicator of who I am, right? Like, who I am, as you're saying, is based on the things I do every day, the way that I respond to people, the help that I give to people, the interactions I have, the engagement that occurs. Like, all these things are much better definitions of who I am. And like, we should get to a point where I have the opt-in choice to aggregate all of that as value and be able to lend against it or take credit against it. You know, and I think that's it. And like, if you look at the developing world, man, like, that is a fundamental game changer, right? Like, you know, you live in a third world country. Well, maybe you don't have identity, but you know, you pay your bills every month. Like, you speak to people on a very often basis. These types of like data feeds and data sets, you have a job, you have an education or something of those sorts. You should be able to use that as a form of leverage, right? And a form of identity, ultimately, to create credit.
Right. So as long as I control it, I guess, is the caveat, right? As long as it's, because I mean, right now, it seems like everybody but me controls my identity. I mean, I luckily didn't send it to Quadriga, but because that's only because I met the guys and they were like, they told me that they were not good people. So, but anyway, that's for another day. We'll talk about that story. But I my point is like, it kills me that identity is one of those things that's like, seems like, you know, an issue that people should be thinking about. So I guess now, whether people want to think about it or not, in Bitcoin at least, you know, they're forced to think about it now, right? So this is because, I guess you could say the hammer is about to drop or is dropping, and there's this pink elephant in the room, which is called like this travel rule. And it's not such a pink elephant rule. Like, I think people really in the industry that run businesses and stuff have known that this was kind of coming and is coming. But more recently, it's like, it feels more imminent. And so as a result, you know, entrepreneurs, like some of the biggest ones, even the ones that are making hundreds of millions of dollars a day, are, you know, tweeting about this as like, you know, potentially as something that, you know, the industry should be waking up towards. So I guess I wanted to talk about this whole, this thing about, because I mean, you know, this was just something that I guess you and I were talking about privately, but now it's like, you know, front news, which is this idea of, okay, so let's talk about what's exactly happening. So, you know, these exchanges are doing KYC, FATF, I guess, as a function of it. And by the way, if I'm butchering it, feel free to step in at any time. They're implementing something called a travel rule, which requires Bitcoin exchanges, crypto exchanges, to insert KYC data inside of every transaction. So if somebody was to send it from, let's say, I won't name any exchanges, but like ABC exchange to XYZ exchange, then the KYC data or the identity data, you know, that they collect at the time that you start with your account would have to be, you know, sent along somehow, such that, you know, and then part two to this, which I guess is the real, you know, kicker, is they're saying that potentially you cannot even withdraw your funds to your, you know, your Trezor, your cold wallet, maybe your smart contract that you want to send it to, which is obviously a big part of what happens in the crypto community. And they're saying that, you know, and eventually what people fear is that they're going to just like not even allow those transactions to occur to your own wallet. So there'll be this almost like this like divided world of like, you know, dark and like white, I guess, if you will, like institutions and, you know, people who are okay. And then another world, which to me sounds, I don't know, weird a little bit, but anyway, so it's like, maybe I'm kind of going on a bit, but yeah. did I butcher it? Like, is that kind of what's happening now? I'm trying to make it very simple, but
make it like really simple.
But sounds super draconian, by the way. I'm not going to lie. Let's just call out the elephant.
It's Swift, right?
Like, huh? It's basically Swift. Okay.
They're trying to basically re-implement Swift. And like, for those who don't know, I'm sure most people listening probably do, but like Swift is the messaging system that messages financial monetary value as well as information or identity information across banks. And they use this to route your wires and transfers all around the world. And so the concept is that we want to know who each exchange's users are and make sure those exchanges can properly do compliance to eliminate things like money laundering and terrorist financing. That's the spirit of the requirements. This one's been a bit of a weird one. You know, we spent like a lot of time advising policy and like trying to, you know, make sure they didn't do this. And this was largely not done out of, I would say, consensus of every country. So everyone, not all countries hate crypto. Some of them are more aggressive on maintaining financial integrity, like the US. Than others. Others are more open to innovation and the idea of change. But this one is a very weird one because like they basically threw this together very quickly. It was rushed. It was not based on how the space works. And so in the traditional world, all the banks are regulated. They are insured. They're banks. Like, you know, they are very big institutions, very well managed by governments. The payments are done from one bank initiating a transaction to another. You can return those payments if things go wrong. It's just a very different world. Look at Bitcoin. Like, I send a Bitcoin to you and it's the wrong address. I'm never getting it back. I don't even need to know who's sending me a Bitcoin and I've received Bitcoin. I can send Bitcoin anywhere around the world. You know, like these things are just fundamentally different. As you said, that might not be a Bitcoin transaction. It could be a smart contract to a smart contract. It can be wallets that are multi-signature. There's so many different things, but the key piece is that this is an open architecture. It's not controlled by banks. It's not mandated by governments. There's no, you know, there is a certain set of rules in the system. Everyone agrees to those rules at the protocol level and open systems flourish. And so let's call it that the regulators on this one didn't take the time to understand what they were doing. It was very rushed. The result of that is, as we talked before, a fundamental impact and change to the way our ecosystem works. And I think that the lessons that we've learned from this as the biggest exchanges in the world is that we collaborate, the lack of collaboration leads to death. Like, we either collaborate right now or die. This is not about competition. It's about cooperation. And I think that's a big lesson to everyone in the space today and any area is like, we have to work together and we have to be a big unified voice to try to fix these things. Like, we've been doing our part on the side, but like, you need the biggest, loudest people to all come together because there's a lot of interests that don't like crypto and don't understand it. And there's a lot of financial money behind keeping systems the way they are, right? So that's like one side. But effectively, like, as to the travel rule, we fixed it. We have a solution. We think that it's probably good. But like the big lessons are huge. Like crypto is not untouchable, guys. We are like Bitcoin, as I said, doesn't care about anything. Crypto doesn't care about any rules, nothing. It is cross-border, it's censorship resistant, it's all these things, but we're humans and we live on a rock, and that rock is governed by laws. And unless that's gonna change, which I don't see happening, those laws are going to get built around how we interact with these systems, how we use them. Are we allowed to use them? How do, like, what's the impact of that? And those social rules project into our usage of these applications, right? And so that's like the core theme. To dive into it, yeah. So the context, I guess, behind the travel rule is that about a year and a half ago, out of pretty much nowhere, it was very much forced, wasn't a lot of collaboration, I would say, on the behalf of global regulators, but this was kind of pushed through the door very quickly. They basically came to the largest exchanges and said, well, they came to us actually first and said, hey, you're going to have 1 year to basically re-architect the entire SWIFT network and somehow allow open systems like Bitcoin and the exchanges that are not insured or regulated, or, you know, it could be an OTC desk in the middle of India that started by one guy yesterday. Like, that's not a big institution, to now be required to hold user data, to securely share that data across different countries, different laws, different GDPR requirements, do all of those things and do them before every Bitcoin or every crypto transaction occurs between you and any other counterparty in the world. You have 1 year, you got it, you'll figure it out. Okay, that's like insane of an ask. If you think about the amount of transactions that happen every day, Bitcoin is also, you can't force those types of things into Bitcoin. So it's not like I can say, Bitcoin, don't send this transaction until you receive data from exchange XYZ, and I verify that data at exchange ABC. So you have a very big issue in that this is a system that doesn't blend with the way that crypto works. And so we've been working with the Financial Action Task Force, who is they're like the only regulatory body in the world that is global. And this is like an important, you know, piece, I think, for everyone, is like the securities laws and these things happen in silos in country to country. But the Financial Action Task Force, which is a mandate of the G20, are effectively in charge of global compliance requirements. So they're there to make sure any money laundering, terrorist financing rules are uniform across every country in the world. So you can't really escape this. And
Joseph, so and FATF, sorry, you talked about travel rule, you talked about FATF, and then OECD. Can you just kind of like just connect the dots? Because I mean, I know this maybe sounds boring to some people, but I think for a lot of entrepreneurs and stuff, they probably had, this is like a black box for them.
So the OECD is effectively the policy and research arm of countries around the world. It was created after World War II. During the reconstruction of Western Europe. And it was mandated to effectively be a body that was funded by the largest nation, the G20. I guess you could call it the G36 right now, as there's about 36 member countries. And what they do is they use the OECD to provide research across all different core functions of societies. So they build standards to say, you know, how do we make sure that slavery is reduced, or that like labor is done properly? How do we make sure that economic free market infrastructure is being done properly? How do we deal with taxation at a global and international level? How do we deal with all these core functions that affect all different parts of an economy? And so they are basically like we give this research. When they give those guidances, all global nations respond, and they basically do whatever they can to meet the OECD's guidelines. It's a very powerful organization. And so the OECD the Financial Action Task Force is similar. They're a policy or a guidance institution, I guess you could say. They were created in the mid-90s. They were created by the G7 and the G20 as they noticed that there was a big problem with terrorism and finance and the financing of criminal activities globally, and investigative units in all these countries called the financial intelligence units, which come out of departments of finance, are basically all a part of the Financial Action Task Force. So The OECD works on global policy across a broad area. Financial Action Task Force is kind of like SEAL Team 6 for like the financial system. So they're there to basically write global policy around how KYC, so know your customer, and anti-money laundering requirements have to be enforced. They're also the people that put people on blacklists. So if countries don't comply, they basically put sanctions effectively on countries by way of putting them in ratings into a blacklist. And so all countries have an incentive to never go to the blacklist because it means that you have a lot of problems, then other countries start cutting you off from services, et cetera.
And IMF, so just throw that in there. Is there a relationship? And just for people, are they just completely different?
Well, they all collaborate together. So I would say that they're collaborative units. The IMF deals more in like global stability on the central bank level, a lot more so, and looking at like how you deal with changes in macroeconomics across different countries, helping countries specifically, at not so much a policy level. They do work on financial policy strictly, but I would say it's more about like how they give aid, how they give guidance, and how do they congregate central banking functions for certain different activities. So that's more of a central bank, I guess, would say a direct focus or financial aid focus.
And full disclosure, you used to be an OECD advisor, right? I think, or you are? Yeah, you were,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. So yeah, full disclosure, I am currently an advisor to the Financial Action Task Force, and I was an advisor to the OECD, and I started a lot of the policy work that went into enabling the G7 and G20 to take a certain stance on crypto. When we went in, it was ban everything. We don't like this. When we left, or when we started to transition out, it was these things are powerful. We can use this to better society. We have to get a couple things right, but don't ban everything. We can get KYC right. If we can get taxation understood, we can let everything else flourish, which before was the opposite of this is scary, this is bad, these are used by criminals. And so that was our main objective. That was my objective, is like we want to make sure policy is only doing the things they need to, not things that kill what we've built for the last 10 years.
Right. And just to kind of fill in the gaps too, like I'm not really part of OECD anyway, but I was invited. Someone was kind enough to invite me to their event last year. It was a really cool. I talk about it a lot. Like I talk about it because Yanni, the founder of eToro, he presented Good Dollar, which I thought was also another really great thing that I learned.
What was your experience? What did you think? What was your takeaway?
I'll tell you that. I mean, just my God, I think about that week a lot. But one of the things that I really, I would say the most fun part for me was when the gentleman from Facebook was on stage in front of like, what, a room full of 1,000, 2,000 regulators, and just watching him, like, I thought Facebook and Libra was one of the like craziest things to happen, because it literally took from Bitcoin and like what we do to being this like super obscure, like random, like I don't need to worry about it, I'm going to retire in 5 years type of phenomena, to Facebook, like the thing that's in my pocket, the thing I'm messaging my mom with now, is literally thinking of like, you know, coming into our territory. So I thought it was just like, it was good. CBDCs, that was another topic, but just to fill in the gap in terms of my thing, you know, as you know, we went through, and you know, maybe we can even on a follow-up, whatever, we can talk about kind of the stuff we went through in India or whatever, but because of a lot of the challenges, I guess you could say, we underwent with the central bank, you know, in the middle of that kind of court case itself, again, I just met some people through, actually because of Don Tapscott, he had invited me to some events. I met some people from the OECD, and eventually they invited me. And so I was there, and it was interesting. I would say my question mark that I, to this day, kind of, I mean, and you know, I think you touched on it earlier, is that this group was essentially formed in the wake of World War II. And its original mandate was to rebuild Europe. I do okay. I mean, even this question of elected officials and all this stuff is obviously under, you know, debate right now, I guess you could say that. Right. But who are these unelected officials?
Like, which ones?
These people that work, that decide that this travel rule will be,
Yeah, like, so the way that, okay, so it's not, okay, so like the, okay, the way that decisions get made in these institutions is that the countries that fund, countries fund them, so Canada, the G7, the G20, they all fund these every year, right? And every year they have representatives of each country that are kind of like dignitaries that live and work inside the OECD. They are there to be the communication feeds back to their governments, finance departments, all the ministers that make up a government, right? And so they have like a communication line back, and the governments make requests, and they all come to consensus. And it's actually an interesting like kind of thing to see, because it really truly is like this, generally speaking, this amazing consensus coordination that happens across all of these like world massive, you know, the economies we live in. And they do have a lot of coordination that goes into like, why do we go after these certain things? How do we fund these types of projects? What types of research are we doing and why, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
So they are, the people there are elected based on the country's social consensus across all these groups of nations around who do we put in which places and why. And then they write the recommendations back to those countries. The countries agree to say this makes sense.
Fascinating. Fascinating. Yeah. I kind of have a bit more insight because I've been, I've been meeting these people, and, but you know, it was the things that I know a lot of people who don't know any of this are probably like, who are, like, I mean, like that was my, when I was standing in that room, even I was like, how did these people come to be like in power? Cause they seem very powerful. Right. But okay, dude. Okay. One thing we didn't do yet. And I think maybe on the next episode, we should do like a deep dive in terms of the project itself. But I do want to touch on, you know, because there was a recent announcement in CoinDesk where Binance announced that they're going to be using Shift, right? They're going to be one of the VASPs for Shift, which in itself is massive. So congratulations on that. And just curious to know, and I know we're going to kind of dive a bit deep into it, but I think we should do like a proper session on that, like an hour and a half or whatever. But I want you to maybe talk now a little bit about, I guess, like, you know, you're an advisor to OECD. How do we, bring it all home for me a bit in terms of, you know, what is it that you and the team, and if you can kind of throw in there, because like, I'm trying to build the theme around Bitcoin. I do talk a lot about RSK, and maybe we don't have to talk about it today, but I know, again, I think there's a lot to it, but just you kind of take it where you want. But I do want to talk about how do we preserve sovereignty and address the concerns of, like, nobody wants terrorists. Like, I mean, I definitely don't, right? How do we, NGU,
like
bad guys go like away. Okay, so how do we make that happen? Simplify in terms.
And like, I would say this too, man, like, you know, like I have like a ton of respect for like the exchanges, and especially like the last like few years, like our ecosystem is like, we we're not expected to know this, but like, we don't really realize that like, there are actually bad people in the world, right? Like everyone's like, oh, screw regulation, like screw regulators, which to some point I agree, some things don't make sense. But like, there are actually bad people that actually do bad things. So like, everyone who just says like, KYC doesn't make any sense, don't ever do this, yada, yada. Like, you should sit inside of a massive institution and see like the really, really weird stuff that happens, man. Like, things are actually real. But, but on the other side, like, it's a bit of an overblown. So, okay, what we wanted to do was to make sure that like, we could build systems that would maintain what we call decentralization, or at least what I more so refer to as censorship resistance. Like, if you're gonna build Swift and are forced by governments to build Swift in crypto, don't build Swift, build Shift the Swift killer, is kind of the way that I put it. Was the idea is like, we need a side chain or a mechanism that can allow any type of protocol, any type of currency asset that exists in our decentralized new world that we're building to be able to route information across counterparties with certain rules, requirements, and really enable something that allows us to discover one another. Because when you look at how how Swift works, I put in a bank code, it's going to this bank, you know, I have this first name and last name, and this is the amount of money, and the banks kind of all communicate on that basis. I know who you are, what bank, what institution, all these things. Those things don't exist in Bitcoin. I have a Bitcoin address, you send it to me, I send it to you, it doesn't matter where you are in the world, I don't even care, and I will never know. And I, let's say I'm a bank, I will never know any information back from you. So we have to solve this problem swift, unfortunately. No one wanted it to be this way, to be honest. Like, we were all really pushing for a different approach to this, because we don't believe that moving my most sensitive data to non-highly regulated institutions is the best idea. Like, this requirement requires massive exchanges who are, by the way, equipped. Like, UnoCoin is equipped to do this. Like, these guys can do this. Like, Binance is equipped to be able to do this. But if you look at a startup with two guys, as I used the example before, who started a week ago, like, there's no guarantees that they're ready to do this. Like, this is a huge security responsibility and a very big financial obligation and compliance. And this is basically, they're asking us to be banks without being banks. So we needed a way to figure out a system that allows us to not break how Bitcoin works, not diminish privacy, not allow or open up exchanges for hacks and attacks, because this becomes, I think, the biggest battleground. In my view, this is going to be the most challenging thing for every crypto company in the space, is now everyone becomes forced compliant honeypots. That's basically what's happening. So we wanted to look at it as a way of saying, okay, if this were to happen, and we built this 2.5 years ago expecting something like this, not really thinking it would happen so fast. This has been forced very, very, very quickly, like a year only. And it's like all pedal to the metal. Everyone's getting regulated out of existence in some ways. So we started building Shift as a way to basically solve what we viewed was the hardest problem in this requirement. The requirement is that I'm exchange A, I have to move data to exchange B in order for a transaction to go from one to another. The deeper dive into that is like one layer below is, my biggest problem isn't moving the data. Like, the internet moves data. Like, we're streaming on the internet now. I can see you, you can see me, audience can see us. That's not the problem. We can move data securely. It's, how do I know that you are Binance? How do I know that you're Tether? How do I know that you're Bitfinex? Like, how do I, as an exchange, discover my counterparty? That's the biggest problem. Because, like, it could be any Bitcoin app. Bitcoin doesn't tell you anything about that. So so we've been working with the largest exchanges in the world. We have about probably 35 or 40 exchanges today, working on top of a protocol that runs on smart contracts. We are working on it as a proof mechanism into Bitcoin, as a way to provide security using the Bitcoin network in a different way than RSK does, but a similar type of kind of construct, but really making sure that we can build an open system that allows us to just move data and coordinate counterparties across all of the largest exchanges and smaller participants as well. And we did this like with the help of the biggest exchanges. So we brought some of the all of the compliance officers from the biggest global liquidity pools in the world together to kind of really build this with us.
Are you able to name kind of like I mentioned Binance, but are you able to mention or is it kind of, yeah?
No, it's fairly public. So Binance was the first to announce. Bitfinex, Quobi, Tether, OKX has been a part of it. Bitthumb has been a part of it. UnoCoin has been a part of it. Even DeFi, actually, what's interesting, we even have DeFi projects.
Let's talk about that a bit. So what does that mean? Like, I mean, and so, so are you saying that, hold on. So are you saying then that, like, again, so, okay, it's about freedom, right? It's about choice. So some people choose that they are okay with parting with their identity because it means that they're able to work with a counterparty that will work with them. And a lot of times, you know, some won't. So if people choose to forgo their, you know, KYC information, you're saying that we can potentially create like gardens within the DeFi world that are KYC, therefore,
yes,
elements you can interact with. Is that correct?
Yeah. And so like the big motivation was that like this is a fully on-chain system. It runs smart contracts to mediate the trust between counterparties and the rules and everything else. But the reason why we designed it that way is it uses public keys as identities. It uses private keys, of course, as those the access points of those identities. And the exchanges are the ones that create effectively identities on KYC information for users. And that solves their how they deal with each other in order to move travel rule information. But when you look beyond that, it also means that it's a fully compatible smart contract system, really a a global compliance layer, an opt-in compliance layer to all public protocols, whether you're on Polkadot, whether you're on Ethereum, you name it. And what that means is that you can start looking at things like compliant DeFi, right? And this is like a big thing. Like, how do you build compliant DEXs if you need to? How do you start building smart contracts that leverage identity as a primitive or compliance as a primitive? That's how you start creating reputation. It's how you start creating lending systems. It's how you allow institutions to start providing liquidity.
I gotta stop you for a second. That sounds like an oxymoron. Compliance DEX. Like, I mean, again, I know what you're saying, but I just want to, like, if most people are hearing that, they'd be like, dude, this guy's off his, you know what I mean, rocker. Like, yeah. So why would the world even want a freaking KYC DEX? Because that is the beauty, if you ask most people. It's so fast, it's so easy.
So our view, and I think there's a lot of people who have a view that, first of all, this isn't a forced system. Like, DEXs will be non-compliant, for lack of a better term, and compliant at the same time. And that's always going to be the case. This is all about optionality. And my view about Bitcoin and everything has always been, I want to be able to give as many people the options to choose what they're comfortable with or what they use. The more they have to choose, the more options, that's my way of expressing freedom. I have the freedom to opt into systems and to opt out of systems. The reality is, like, we think that crypto, it hit $1 trillion and or $1 billion, $100 billion, $1 trillion, whatever, is like exciting. But like, what we don't realize, and I think we're just an early market, the size of the financial system is like 10, 100 orders of magnitude bigger than our tiny little ecosystem, right? And what we don't know, and what most of us don't realize, is like, if we want crypto to permeate everything, that like institutions, the guys who really hold the money, let's call it that, the ones that really progress financial systems forward today, are not able to go into DeFi. They're not able to go into DEXs, and it's because of compliance. So that, like, the rule in compliance is that if you have one counterparty involved in a trade that you don't know, then you are not allowed to enter into any trades in that system. What it means is that the largest institutional capital today cannot put money into DeFi, because if they do and they accidentally get a compliance issue, they're screwed. So again, this isn't saying everyone's forced into a Uniswap compliance system. It's that there's a very large market that might not be the one that we are in today, or the people that are in our market today, that want access to these services to make financial services more efficient, more effective, to change the way that systems work. We're never going to get institutions adopting DeFi systems if they're not allowed to, right? Like, they are legally not allowed to touch these things. And that's very different from a Bitcoin system. It's not just about figuring out, can I trust this thing? Is there risk? It's not that. It's, we can't do this because we don't know who's on the other side, right?
And Joseph, what's been the, and again, I know I want to be mindful of your time. By the way, how are you doing for time? Do you have a bit more, or do you want to maybe kill it in about 10 here? How are you doing?
We can do 10 minutes and then we can do
Okay, cool. So let's bring it. So I wanted to just address one more thing. So there's also, so it sounded like a lot of the exchanges you mentioned were more like Asian exchanges, right? And it seems like there's also maybe an emergence of some other, you know, whatever entities that are trying to solve a similar problem set. Do you think eventually, like, all these networks will, you know, communicate between one another? Or do you think it's important for network effects to happen on certain ones? Or just curious, like, any thoughts around that? Because there's a lot of my people that I think maybe even listen to this that are probably in North America.
Yeah, so I think that there will, I mean, it'll be interesting to see what happens now. Like, we built this thing over 3 years and we had a 10 to 15 year vision in place. And so the every single design decision that went into building Shift was with the expectation that this wasn't just to solve the travel rule, and it wasn't just to solve one piece of identity. Like, you need a system that is wholly built to solve 50 or 60 problems as a general purpose architecture. What that means is, like, non-custodial compliance, or this problem the US is having, like, you know, if you're sending money to a non-custodial or a smart contract, like, that doesn't work in the way these other systems have been built today. And so, like, the other solutions are not designed to be able to work on smart contracts. They're not designed to work against public and private keys. They're not designed to solve these actual on-chain issues.
Okay.
And so you have like a wholly integrated system. So I think that network effects have been the most important thing. It's also why like we brought together the largest liquidity sources in the world, like the Asian or global exchanges, the stable coins are the biggest. They're all working together because they know that they distribute effects across everyone very quickly. And that was really important, right? Like the US is in a different situation. They have a lot more issues, to be honest with you. And so Coinbase and Gemini and the others, they're working on a much more closed, they're basically rebuilding Swift, to be very honest with you. Contractual agreements, they're not using protocols, they're not trying to kind of solve all these problems at once. And I think that they're going to have a challenge. They're going to have a very hard time because even the new guidance that came out in the last month, it breaks the way that they were approaching things. So like they're going to have to rebuild things and rethink things, like, you know, and so I think there will be an integration or an interoperability that occurs. But I don't think there'll be more than two really big solutions because like over time, like if you can't connect to Binance, like then you can't really like use it, right? If you can't connect to BitMEX, if you can't connect to Tether, like Tether is everywhere, you know, like Tether is everything. And so we worked very closely with the other projects and love them. They're great teams. They're helping. But I think that network effects, just like liquidity effects, there's no difference, right? Like you need the biggest guys to permeate a standard across all of the smaller counterparties in the world. And it's all, yeah, sorry, go for it.
You know, I was going to say, are you able to just, you know, I'm sure people can look it up, but just like, are you able to mention who some of the advisors are for this project to Shift?
Yeah. Yeah, we were very lucky on that too. Like we had a very good mixture. So, you know, we had a lot of the crypto OGs. We have, yeah, Melton Demirers, you know, Brock Pierce, a lot of the older guys, I guess. Push and progress things forward. Oh, wait. Can you hear me still? Sorry.
Yeah, your voice cut out there. I heard Meltem, and then who was it one after that?
Meltem, Brock. Like, we kind of have a mixture of three different core groups. We have old regulators. We have the head of the Financial Action Task Force. So the guy who actually ran the FATF, Rick McDonald. yeah.
Okay.
Rick and also Jose Nadeau, who was the head of the Financial Action Task Force delegate for the Department of Finance in Canada. They've been actually, they're the ones who are chairing and leading the initiative with the exchanges. And so they've been really helping on global policy, how we communicate across all of these international.
Uh-oh. Two, one. Okay, we're back, minus some technical difficulties. Okay, so you were just going to, I guess, finish up on you said Anthony, did you mention Anthony Dirio as an advisor?
Nobody's one of them.
He's one of them. Okay, cool. I think you mentioned Meltem. So you've got all these like really awesome people from the crypto space, very reputable people. You've got people from FATF, I think you mentioned as well, like ex-FATF, you know, heads, which is probably a good thing if you're going to embark on this journey. And then you're saying there's like a third category, I think.
Yeah, well, so like what we wanted to do was bring like the best people and the brightest people from like three different core areas, right? It was really about like, how do we bring the people that lead policy, the people who, you know, really make regulations happen. And that was like one of the key pillars. The other one was, how do we bring the biggest names, the brightest guys, the oldest people from the crypto space all together? And of course, you know, how do we bring a team that can really, you know, build these things out and do this at a global scale? And so, I've been like really proud of the work that we've done on that side. So we have, you know, all the names that you'd probably know in crypto. So, you know, ex Blockstream architects, you know, guys who like really started and invented a lot of like federated systems designs, liquid network stuff, you know, really like Bitcoin cypherpunks. So that was kind of the one side. Anthony Diorio, Diego, of course, who runs RSK, Marat. So Bitfury has been a very big supporter, one of the largest Bitcoin miners in the world, Meltem Demirers. And a variety of others, of course, on the crypto side, Brock Pierce and others, with all very different perspectives in different areas where they can help, because it's such a big, vast project. And then, on the other side, it was, you know, how do we bring the institutional guys, right? Like, we have the VP and head of MasterCard, who has been a big supporter of the project. We have the head of Corp Dev at Paysafe, which is the like one of the largest payment processors in the world, more of the traditional side, I think, of things. And we wanted that kind of blend of, you know, institutional you know, focus, right? Because we're building things to try to bridge the gap of everyone. And then the last kind of really big piece was, how do we bring people that write policy, you know, and help, you know, lead this forward? So the ex-head of the Financial Action Task Force has been leading this entire initiative with all the exchanges. We have chief compliance officers of the exchanges, actually, who were early advisors of Shift, who made all of these things really come and become possible. A lot of heads of some of the largest banks in Canada on the compliance side, too, actually have been advisors as well for the project, which has been amazing. And last but not least, the big actually ones that I find to be interesting were, we actually brought two of the lords from the House of Lords to the project. For those that don't know, they basically are the advisors to the Queen of England. And so they basically write.
That's crazy.
Yeah, right. Like it's that's been really cool, because like when you think of England as a very powerful, you know, political, you know, part of the world, and when you think about it from a common law perspective, there's 58 or so countries that all run in the same British mandated systems, and so our ability to kind of work internationally across all of these areas are greatly enhanced through the work of the House of Lords, which is the upper house of Parliament in the UK. So they've been incredible, and both from an economic advisory perspective and a political and geopolitical perspective, they've been incredible. And then Loretta and a variety of others have really been helping us write policy and write regulations and really help on the OECD and a lot of other areas. So it's just been an amazing group of people. And it's the first project I've seen where you have people, co-founders of Ethereum, co-founders of Cardano, co-founders are like very early Bitcoin OGs, if you will, all come together, right? Like, you know, these are people who are experts in these different areas and started a lot of these different parts of the space. They're usually very contentious. They all and everyone has kind of come together for a common goal, which is like, we need the ecosystem to survive. We need Bitcoin to survive, right? Like if Bitcoin can survive and we can build infrastructure through Shift to express that regulatory requirements or those policies at the protocol level, we can actually solve everyone's problems, right? So it's very much a collaborative project as opposed to my chain versus your chain or, you know, any of that stuff. It's really like Shift is there to help Bitcoin first and foremost and every business that runs on it and its adoption. And at the same time, every other party and network that's being built in the space regardless. So we like that approach, is like, you know, be friendly and work to solve problems with everyone who needs it. So no competition, only collaboration. So
cool, man. And then, you know, in our last conversation, Joseph, we kind of started with Paycase. We talked about, you know, there was a really cool story there. People can check it out, you know, in the other video. And then this one, we talked quite a bit about identity, which I thought was, you know, really interesting. Again, it was something that I'll be honest, like I didn't think a lot about until you and I have, you know, in the last few years have been talking more about it. And so I do believe that it's an important cornerstone. Like money is obviously to me, like kind of the monumental one to solve, but I could see how identity is a close second, perhaps. And you know, people like Naval have been tweeting about it recently. I don't know if I think I shared that tweet with you, right? Where he was saying how money and then computing, but then, you know, you'll have identity and these things kind of reputation and these things be on networks. Anyways, dude, I know this has kind of been, we went over a time-wise. I want to be respectful of your calendar. I know you're busy. So, I would love to do this again sooner than later. There's a lot of people out there that seem to be very interested in this topic. I know I definitely am. And it's also like one of those things that I don't see anybody talking about really, yet it's super important. So that to me signals that, you know, we should probably our duty to provide more light. And I think people need to know, right? Like people in the crypto industry are curious about this stuff, and it's our role to kind of, you know, demystify some of this stuff. And I've been fortunate enough to, you know, have the journey I've had, and I've gotten to see a lot of cool things. And so, let's do that. And you know, even if we want to get a little bit more technical or cover more legal things, we'll see what people are interested in, and kind of dive down those. But do you want to leave people? One thing you didn't mention is like kind of the website for Shift. And then once again, kind of your maybe Twitter handle where people tap into your consciousness.
Yeah, so you can find more about Shift on Telegram at Shift Network. Shift.network is the website. And reach out, you know, we're always around. We have mediums and blogs to learn a lot more about kind of this area and this topic. We'll be doing newsletters as well that kind of gives these monthly updates around like regulatory things happening. So it could be a good source for people to understand, you know, where the space is going in this big complex sphere. Rest assured, people are working on these problems. We're just doing it in a bit of a closed door fashion. And then, yeah, you can find me on Twitter at Joseph Weinberg, Telegram at Joseph Weinberg. That's probably the best way. So, yeah.
Well, that's great, man. Sounds good. Let's bring this one to a close. I'll upload this one in the next day or so. And then, yeah, we'll take it from there. All right. Thanks, awesome. Joseph.
Thanks so much, Sonny. Appreciate it. Cool.